genetic research and the incorporation of genetic research into social and behavioral research is absolutely critical because these behaviors are the result of both genetic predispositions and the environment. So when you just study one part of the puzzle, you're missing other important influences. How important candidate gene studies are as a method is, I think, up for some debate. And the issue here is that historically, candidate gene studies were all the rage. And the idea was that we know something about the underlying biology of these disorders, so we can pick what genes are likely to be important in these outcomes, and we'll now study how the risk associated with that gene unfolds across development or interacts with these other sorts of factors. I've done some of this research as well. One of the limitations of this is that we know that any one gene studied in isolation only has a very small effect. So studying candidate genes one at a time, when we know there's probably hundreds, maybe thousands of genes involved in the outcome, and we're going to pick out one and try and understand the risk associated with it. That a lot of that has been done, and as I mentioned, I have done a lot of work in that area. But as we identify more genes involved in the predisposition, I don't know how useful that will be going into the future. So now there's been a movement toward GWAS studies, so genome-wide association studies. The idea here is that with candidate genes, we have to know something about the underlying biology. The reality is we still don't know a lot about the underlying biology of most of these outcomes. And historically, we haven't been very good at picking candidate genes. Well, now what we can do with all these advances in genetics is scan the entire genome. So we don't need to know anything a priori about what genes are involved in outcome. This should, in theory, allow us to discover new genes and to open up new pathways in terms of understanding risk pathways that we might have never guessed or known anything about. And that has happened in other disorders, diabetes, Crohn's disease. It has not happened in psychiatric outcomes, in social and behavioral sciences. It has, in fact, the era of genome-wide association studies has been somewhat disappointing when it comes to the phenotypes we're most interested in, these behavioral and psychiatric phenotypes. It has, I think, underscored the incredible complexity of our phenotypes. So now there is this movement toward, well, maybe it's not common variation, maybe it's rare variation. So genome-wide association studies are very good at capturing common variants that exist throughout the genome. And we know that some of that is important, and certainly we have found some genes. But what we've also learned is that these genes have very small effects on their own, which means the sample sizes we need are huge. Originally, we thought, oh, a few thousand might be good. Now, when you're looking at things like BMI, so body mass index, or height, we're looking at consortiums where they have data from more than 100,000 individuals to be able to find genes involved in something like height. And they're still only accounting for a small percentage of the variants. Now, you would think that measuring something like height and weight, that's got to be far easier than measuring something like what is alcohol dependence, what is depression, what are conduct problems in kids. So this is where phenotype becomes very important. But even when you know something about your phenotype and you can measure it very well, it demonstrates that clearly common variation is only part of what contributes to genetic differences between individuals. So one of the things we're now looking at is rare variation. So variants that aren't very frequent in the population, but it might be I carry my own personal mutations, my own personal set of pretty rare genetic variants, but they contribute to my outcome. And alcohol dependence in another person might be due to a whole set of their own rare variants. And so now it becomes even more complicated when you think that what contributes to these outcomes in different people might be different mutations, which might be in the same gene or might be across a whole different set of genes, and maybe you only need a portion of those variants in a portion of those genes, and hence this might contribute to the fact that there's different pathways of risk in different individuals. So phenotyping becomes very important, and there's been a movement away from just looking at clinical diagnoses as an outcome to perhaps more quantitative phenotypes. Instead of looking at alcohol dependence, let's look at drinking patterns in general. We know that quantity, frequency of alcohol use are also genetically influenced. Let's look at what's been called endophenotypes or intermediary phenotypes. If something like sensation seeking is on the pathway to alcohol dependence, well, let's look at genes involved in sensation seeking, or let's look at genes involved in response to alcohol, how you actually respond to an alcohol challenge, these kinds of things. So there's kind of been this philosophy of we're going to pursue a lot of different avenues because no one has really been the answer yet in identifying genes.